We are talking with Don Fox. He's a principal deputy director of United States Office of Government Ethics. You have been here in Romania for 2 days.
That's correct.
Understood.
Yes.
You've met magistrates and National Integrity Agency officials.
Yes.
What are the basic differences you have noticed between your institution and the Romanian one, the National Integrity Agency?
It's a very good question. Well, first of all, you have to start with the fact that we have two very different forms of government.
Right.
Yours is a parliamentary system in which really all the officials throughout the country are part of the government. Ours, of course, is very different. We have a federal system in which we have a federal government, but then we have a whole great number of state and local officials who really are answerable only to those states and to their localities. In addition, we have three separate but equal branches of government. So my office is responsible for the ethics standards and regulations that govern some 3 million executive branch employees, which includes 1 million members of our military.
But in terms of power, let's say, what do you verify exactly? I mean, the declaration of assets or what?
That's a good question as well. In terms of declaration of assets, our system is somewhat different than yours. It's very common throughout the world, and we work with a number of countries around the world to have asset declarations. That is to try and verify or correlate someone's actual wealth with their public salary. Our system is designed very differently. Our system is designed from the beginning as a prevention of conflicts of interest tool. We are not so concerned with the actual amount of someone's wealth as we are really where their investments and financial interests lie. That might include property they own, stock. It might include where their spouse works. So our declaration does not include nearly the percentage of population or workers that yours does. And it's used as a counseling tool to counsel our employees about how to avoid conflicts of interest in the first place.
So your activity is, if I understand right, is focused on preventing, not on verifying and sanction.
That's absolutely correct. In fact, the law states that the purpose of our office is to prevent conflicts of interest in the executive branch.
What is the degree of transparency in the U.S.? What information is requested to be included in the statement of assets?
Well, and there are two types of financial disclosure. There are public financial disclosure, which is available to anyone who requests it. There's also confidential financial disclosure. Public financial disclosure is reserved for our most senior political appointees, as well as senior career civil servants, such as myself. So in those requests, we will want to know sources of investment, sources of income. We will want to know about a person's debts and liabilities. We'll want to know about any gifts that they may have received to make sure that they complied with our gift rules. We'll want to know if they hold any positions outside the government. And lastly, if they have any arrangements for future employment outside the government.
Could you give us an example? What are the most important cases you have worked on recently?
Well, it's really hard to talk about specific cases because you can understand that a number of those cases may still be under investigation. Because we have a very well-compensated civil service and our civil service is politically protected, that is, 99% of the people who work for the federal government can't be removed simply because we have a change in parties in the White House. We are not really so concerned or have the problem with sort of base corruption in the United States. So while actual criminal prosecutions of federal officials are very few, and they do arise, sadly, and they arise in situations that you might imagine, contracts that are awarded improperly or inside information being leaked. There's only a handful of those each year.
So your file could be sent away to prosecutor, but it doesn't happen very often that.
It doesn't happen very often because we simply don't have that many significant violations. Now, Those 3 million people I mentioned work in over 135 agencies. People in their agencies have full power and authority to administer administrative sanctions against them for maybe smaller infractions. Mm-hmm. Perhaps somebody took a gift that was only slightly above what is permitted, and maybe they weren't aware of what the rules were. That could be a rather small administrative sanction on that employee. On the other hand, there could be something more severe but doesn't rise quite to the criminal level. In those cases, a person could be removed by their agency from the federal workforce.
It's very different, your system, that we have here in Romania, but I think we have something in common. Mm-hmm. Politicians are not very happy with such an agency. And here in Romania, they try all the time to limit the power of the agency.
If your question is, do we experience that same sort of pressure in the United States?
Right.
I would say we don't really experience the same sort of overt pressure, though I think that public officials the world over, and people, and it makes sense, have some reluctance to have their financial and other involvement sort of laid bare for public inspection. So yes, I think that there's always some sensitivity about that. I would say that even in a time of shrinking budgets in the United States, the Congress and indeed the administration have shown really great support for our work. Mm-hmm. And have not cut our funding or our ability to do our jobs.
But do they respect the decisions of the agency, or do they attack your activity in public space?
Actually, our agency and the ethics program generally, I think, is very well respected. And it's just a function that's not perceived to be very good politics in the United States to come out and oppose ethics in any way. The American population and voters just wouldn't react very well to that.
Okay. And one more question. We have a case in Romania. I wouldn't say any name. And we don't know precisely if it would be an instance of conflict of interest in United States. Let's presume that Mr. X represents in Romania a private air company A, and he has become a manager of state-owned air company B. Would this be an instance of conflict of interest in the U.S.?
Well, we start with our basic conflict of interest prohibition, which says that any federal employee is prohibited from taking any official action that could affect any entity in which they have a financial interest.
Right.
So the scenario that you posed would make it really untenable for the person to do their government job, since they both directly involved aircraft. That's a situation, should that happen in the United States, and again, thinking that our purpose is to prevent conflicts, we'd probably say to the individual, you need to choose one position or the other, because they're simply incompatible for you to do both.
Have there been times in the institution's activity when politicians tried to limit its scope, to cut the power of your agency? Because this happened in Romania several times.
Sure. If there are, I'm not aware of it. Our agency was actually born as one of the post-Watergate reforms, a whole wave of reforms in the United States. Mm-hmm. To create more greater openness and transparency. Mm-hmm. Within the United States federal government. It may well be because of that legacy that political figures have always shown actually great deference to the federal ethics program and what we do.